good afternoon. So the lunch was great today, but because I'm talking, I couldn't eat as well as I ate yesterday. My name is Pushkar. I work for a team called Runtimes in IBM. So I'm going to take you through this new language. It's not new, it's 2 years old as of now, called Swift. There's my Twitter handle. The pattern of my Twitter handle is very similar to Sachin Tendulkar's, but I did it before him. You can also follow me on GitHub. So the recipe for today is some introductions about myself, about my company, I mean what we do in runtimes. Also, I don't want to directly start talking about Swift. I just want to tell you a story from the beginning of the actual birth of functional programming and how events unfolded to reach languages like Swift and Go and Rust. Very short one, nothing great about it. Most of you who have been interested in functional programming will know it, but I just wanted to maintain that continuity. Just didn't want to pitch into Swift and start. Then I'll just take you through basics, how to write. So I'm planning to do a hands-on here. So if you have a Mac, you can use the playgrounds, or you can use a Xcode project. If you don't have a Mac, if you have Windows, I'll tell you how to do it in the browser. If you have Ubuntu installed, I'll tell you another way to run Swift. So I'll take you through closures, map filter reduce, lazy sequences, currying, pattern matching, pure functions and memoization. And the last one is starred, because I'm very new to it. If you have questions, then we have to think about the answers together. That's functors, applicatives and monads in Swift. So some introductions about me, functional programming and Swift. So I started working in IBM 8 years ago. I'm still in IBM. I started with Java just-in-time compiler. I used to work on customer crashes. So when customers face a crash in Java, they're running their Java app and it suddenly goes down and they get a core dump, sometimes 16 GB core file, sometimes 32 GB core file. They just give you the dump file and solve this problem. So if it's a problem in the just-in-time compiler, you have to sit, dump all the instructions, keep looking at the instruction manual, or move, read, and whatnot. So I did that for 5 years, only reading assembly instructions on PowerPC, x86, and so on. Then I switched to class library development. By class library development, I mean all the Java standard library classes. So my team contributes to OpenJDK, but when I was working on it, we didn't have that push to contribute to OpenJDK. We maintained our own libraries and we worked with Oracle for that. Last year, that's December of 2015, Swift was open sourced, and we started working on bringing Swift to Linux. It's a community effort and we are involved. We are a part of the community. So same, who am I, what do? I've already told you that. Why and how am I here? So what is my functional programming story? So somehow the term functional programming never caught my attention until the last year. So I'd heard of this debate in the press back in 2008 when I joined the industry, saying, why don't we have closures in Java? And I said, what are these closures? I'm not sure, and I don't know why these people are fighting. I left it there. I did see a couple of posts on functional programming. I never cared to look into what that is. In April last year, that is April 2015, I happened to attend a conference in Bangalore, and one of the keynote speakers was Venkat Subramanian. I hope all you guys know him. And then I was enthralled. And then I attended all his talks that day, and in a day I was brainwashed. In one day. That's the power of that man. I was brainwashed in a day, started looking at Java 8, started playing around with Haskell, though I didn't go much further with Haskell, but I got into the You know, that bug hit me, bug of functional programming hit me. And after that, I also attended this conference last year, learned a lot. I actually got a direction about how to go about learning what I like to do. So that's how I'm here. What my team does, just a short slide, we have our own Java runtime called J9. It's open source now. In case you're interested, you can just Google for it and visit the site. Then we also have something called the Open Managed Runtime, which gives garbage collection and JIT services. If you want to implement your own language, you can use what is called OMR. This is also an open source project. So there are implementations of Ruby and Python running on the JVM using OMR as well. We also contribute to the OpenJDK. Then there are people who work on the community Node.js effort and the Express.js. And the last two have started just this year. So I'm a part of the Swift Foundation Libraries team. So we work on, okay, 1 minute, a show of hands. How many of you are Swift programmers here? That's low. Okay. Fine, so I'll tune my talk. Likewise. So Swift Foundation libraries are some utility libraries which are built on top of the standard library, and I'll come to that, but we are involved in Swift libraries and dispatch. There's a concurrency framework called dispatch, or the GCD, or the Grand Central Dispatch. So we are also involved in that. And there is our web services framework for Swift called Kaitura, or some call it Kitura as well. So let me start. So I like this picture a lot. So we can assume that the beginning of all creation is the lambda. So these three people were very instrumental to the birth of functional programming. So leftmost is Alonzo Church. So Church was interested in coming up with a theory which described mathematics. Okay, like it's like a meta theory which described maths. And he apparently terribly failed at it, but his work got used to come up with something called lambda calculus. Lambda calculus is the seed of functional programming. The second picture is of Stephen Kleene. That person actually came up with the recursion theory. So recursion, as John said today, it's inseparable from functional programming. So Kleene was the one to come up with recursive function theory. And the last guy there, brilliant chap, Turing, I have starred him because he was not directly involved in the formulation of lambda calculus or the recursive function theory. He was Alonzo Church's student, and he proved that Church's hypothesis, that is lambda calculus, was Turing complete. So you know what is the meaning of Turing complete? A language is Turing complete if any problem solvable in this universe can be solved using that language. So he proved that lambda calculus was Turing complete, which meant there was an alternate discipline possible to programming. Functional programming takes a mathematical approach to programming. It's based on lambda calculus, category theory, and type theory, as against imperative programming, which is a very pragmatic approach. So let me go to the next slide. Why I say it's a pragmatic approach. So these were the early adopters, these languages. So Lisp came out in 1958, and John McCarthy was, who the creator of Lisp was highly influenced by Church's theories. And Lisp was the first language which adopted functional programming. Now, it's important that it came out at the same time as Fortran, roughly the same period. And these were two parallel disciplines, because Fortran was based more on a practical approach to programming. So before, as John said today, before compilers or languages came, people used to handwrite assembly code. And when you handwrite assembly code, you're looking at memory as an array of bytes. You're doing everything one word at a time. So if you have to print a string, you go You know the location of the first byte, you go fetch the first byte, print it, second byte, print it, third byte, print it. You're doing everything word at a time. Now that thinking came into programming, even after languages were created. That particular thinking of doing everything one word at a time, it overflowed into programming. Whereas the parallel stream, that is functional programming, was born in mathematics. So Lisp was the first one. I think Lisp had many flavors after that. The scheme, racket, closure. So ML was the second, which inspired OCaml and F#. Miranda, which inspired Haskell, was also among the early adopters. And there was Erlang, and I think Haskell was the, I personally feel it was the first most successful functional language, because it is purely functional. All the other languages don't, except Miranda, because Miranda is what inspired Haskell, don't enforce functional concepts on you. Then in 1995, after the JVM was born, people started thinking of functional programming on JVM, on the JVM. Groovy, Scala, so Java was lagging behind. Scala actually went past Java when they came up with functional programming. Then there was Clojure. Finally, in 2014, Java succumbed and they said, okay, we have to come out with lambdas and streams and all. But after that, if you have noticed, because a giant like Java has started talking about functional programming, the world has started talking about functional programming. That's just an observation I have. So after that, there was a thought, why is every application supposed to be running on a virtual machine? Do we need that? And then people started moving away from virtual machines and back to native languages. So before we had these virtual machines, you know, JVM and V8, Python, we did have languages like the old languages like C and C++, which were compiled and ran on bare metal. They didn't have a layer in between. So people started thinking to go back, complete a full circle, and Go was born in 2011. Rust in 2013, and then Swift came out in 2014. Now these languages are called modern native languages. Some people also add another language here, that is, they call it modern C++. That is, I think, based on C++ 17 and C++ 14 standards, because that has lambdas and all that. But largely these three are the languages which are called modern native languages. Now modern native languages have three major requirements. They have to be fast, because the sole purpose for resorting to them was to avoid the performance degradation given by virtual machines. They have to be fast, they need to be safe. You have to ensure compile time safety, because a Java virtual machine can give you runtime safety. You have exceptions and all that. But once you don't have a virtual machine, your safety needs to come at compile time. So safety was one requirement, and the third one was expressive nature. The language needs to be very, very expressive. And somewhere these two requirements, I think, led to these language designers to embrace functional programming. Because functional programs, when you write functional programs, you need a very, very expressive language. You don't want boilerplate code there. And of course, safety comes with a good type checker and good type systems. So Swift was created by a person called Chris Lattner. He was actually heading the LLVM team. He was hired by Apple in 2010 and asked to work on a very secret project. And in 2014, WWDC, Apple announced this programming language called Swift. Now Swift is a modern native language. It is expected to eventually replace Objective-C, though that's happening at a snail's pace here in India. It was open sourced in 2015. Now that's a very prominent milestone, because I am talking to you about Swift and I don't have any mobile background, any mobile development background. I'm talking to you only because Swift has been open sourced and there is an effort to make it work on Linux. So initially it was restricted to Apple platforms, just like Objective-C. If you wanted to try Swift, you needed a Mac. Your code could run either on a Mac, an iPhone, an Apple TV or iWatch. These together are called Darwin platforms. But now it's available on Linux. You have to visit swift.org and you have downloads for Ubuntu there. Swift is multi-paradigm. Swift does not, it's not a purely functional programming language like Haskell. And if you visit the Wikipedia page, it says it borrows heavily, because Swift has been created using the best features from a multitude of languages. Now when I meet people in meetups and I show Swift code to them, some people say it looks like Python, some say it looks like JavaScript, some say it looks like C++. That's because it has the best features from most languages. And I always tell them that whatever language you come from, you're going to find Swift similar to that language, because that is how it has been designed. It has static typing and there is type inference. So I think most modern languages have type inference, so not a great deal. In my perception, Swift is very intuitive. So once you get an initial hang of it, you can just guess how to go about solving your problems. That's been my experience in the last 6 months. You just write some code and it works. That is how it has been designed. It is very beautiful. Of course, beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder, but I think it's a very beautiful language. It has a good compile time safety. Optionals, I'll talk about optionals. Decent functional programming aspects, I'll cover them today. The only problem is memory management can be painful at times. If you are working with, when you're working on the server side with Swift, the automatic reference counting, there is no garbage collector because it is not, it doesn't have a virtual machine. Though Go also doesn't have a virtual machine, it does have a garbage collector. But Swift doesn't have a garbage collector, and you have to sometimes manage memory on your own. Sometimes, not always. I have come across situations where I had to hold on to memory, not let it, be collected. So goals for the next 75 minutes. It is appreciate some general functional concepts. Start playing around with Swift's functional constructs. We'll solve some simple problems and we'll try appreciating those three functors, applicatives, and monads. So, if you're interested in following me with the hands-on, you have three options. If you don't have a Mac, you can use what we call the IBM Swift Sandbox. I'm going to use that, so I'll tell you how to start using it. It is to be used in the browser. If you are a Ubuntu and a command line interface fan, then you can just visit swift.org and download the latest binary. If you have a Mac, then you can use Xcode or the Xcode playground. So let's get started. We'll be learning one concept at a time. These examples are highly contrived. They are very, very academic in nature. So they may not relate to the real world. And the third statement is what people say, that whenever there is a functional programming tutorial, Fibonacci and prime numbers have to come in. Why? But you just can't do without them, because they are really good examples to learn functional programming. So I'm going to stop the slideshow. So if you want to use the IBM Swift Sandbox, you should just Google for IBM Swift Sandbox. And the first link should take you there. It's based on Linux, so when you write and submit your code, the code is packaged, sent to a remote Linux machine. It runs there and comes back. The results are sent back. So here is how it looks. So I'm just going to run Hello World, start off. Now let's start. Yeah, I also have a Git project here which I created yesterday. In case I stumble, and if you can't help me out, I'll fall back on these code snippets. So let me remove this. So the left side, if you're using this box, the left side is where you write your code, and the right side is where you see your results. So let me run it once. It's running. Is it visible to the last row there? Or do you want me to increase the resolution? Are you able to see the code? Yeah, great. So closures are, they are like lambdas in Java. There's the general concept of a closure, unnamed blocks of code that can be passed around. They capture the context. In Swift, they capture the variables also. They're typically supposed to capture only values that are only constants. But in Swift, they capture variables as well. And even after you send a closure out from a function, somewhere else you can actually change the variable from the, of that function, which is bizarre. But we need not use that because I don't think that can fit into functional programming. So we'll say that they capture only values. The major use case of closures is asynchronous programming. There is a lot of asynchronous programming happening in Swift. Rx Swift and there is URL session and Alamo Fire and all that. When you say asynchronous programming, you are actually sending a completion handler. A completion handler is nothing but a closure, which is supposed to be run when a certain condition, when a certain event occurs. So for closures, I'll take you to the basic syntax. I'll show you how type inference and implicit returns work there. Then there's something called shorthand. So let's start. So here we'll try to write a generic binary operator. These are very simple examples. Highly academic and contrived. So let's write a generic binary operator. So you may, if you don't understand any part of the code, just feel free to interrupt me. Now when you say, when you're declaring an argument, you have to, so there are two names for it. One name which is used by the function that is calling you, and the other name which is used internally. So if you want to allow people to call your function without any argument name, you just write an underscore here. So let me just, it's a binary operator, so let's say x and y. And the third one should be a closure, because we want to make this a generic binary operator. And generic reminds me of generics. Let's make it generic. And here you say, I will take a function which takes two arguments of type T and returns an argument of type T. And let me call it op. Don't have the underscores, then when you're calling it, you'll have to use x colon. You'll have to use a named argument. I don't think the compiler that's left to the compiler. I don't think it follows the order, but that is more of something which is carried over from Objective-C, because Objective-C since 1984 did have these argument names, external names and internal names. So Swift is just carrying over. It's a baggage. So this will return T, and I just say return op xy. Let's see if it compiles. Yeah, it's compiled. So what I'm doing here is defining a binary operator. Just ignore these T's. They are all the generics here. So one operator, second operator, and an operation. That operation takes, I have to specify the type of that operation. So it is taking two arguments of type T and returning an argument of type T. And finally, the return value is of type T. So if you don't understand this, just let me know. We can spend more time. Now, so underscore X, okay, let me do one thing. So let's say a function say x into 2, x2. Okay. Now I say x int return x. That's compiling. Now, if I have to call x2, typically we will say x2, right? But here it says, there's a compiler error, it says missing argument label x. Because when you are defining an x, you have to call it like this. Yeah, that's just a warning. Alternately, you can also say yx, and then you can use y here. If you use underscore, you're telling the compiler that I don't care about argument names. So if I just say a print here, so back to the binary operator. So let's pass an addition function now. So binary operator of 1, 2. And then I will write the first closure, and it's like this: a int, b int, in, return a plus b. Don't worry, it's not this verbose later, but just to show you all possible ways of doing it. So what I'm doing here is I'm passing 1, 2 and an operation which will add 1, 2. So it gives me 3. Now if I just say this and I say 4, it should give me 8. Perfect. Now you can actually reduce this closure, it need not be so verbose. What I can do is I can remove this return. Return is implicit, and I can also remove these types. I can just say AB. Let's run it. 8 again. So let's try something else. Binary operator. Say, let's have strings. Hello. Now, so this closure is the last argument of that function. So Swift allows you to pass it after you close. Okay, let me not talk about it. Let me just show you. So instead of passing this as an argument, you know, before that closing brace, I can write it like this: a, b in a plus b. So let's print x1. It should be hello world. Yeah, it's hello world. So this is the other way. This is called a trailing closure. When you have a trailing closure, you can actually push it out, you know, of the function call and write it after your function call is over. Yeah, only the last closure. Now something shorter than this, let me remove this. In a closure, the first argument has an implicit name, and that is $0. And the second argument has an implicit name, $1. So this also is a closure. I'm running it, hello world. It doesn't stop there. Operator closures are something cooler than this. So let me remove this. And I just pass a plus here. That's it. So you saw from where we started and how we went on reducing the code. And this is how you know, this is how beautiful Swift is. Perhaps, yeah. But plus is defined as an operator, so you can actually say plus, you know, following the, what was that, referential transparency. You can actually, let's see if it works. Plus 1, 2. I'm not sure, never done this. No, doesn't work. I think it is yes, special handling. Yes. Yeah, it is compiled, of course. So I think that is what I wanted to tell you about closure. So as we write the map filter reduce functions, we'll come across more and more closures. Now let's talk about higher order functions. This is a higher order function because it is taking it's taking code as an argument. You can also pass functions instead of that code there. So higher order functions are any function that takes a function as an argument or returns a function is a higher order function. Everything else is first order function. So derivatives are a very good example of higher order functions. Just think of them. When you're doing d by dx, you're working on a function and you're returning a function. When it's only f of x, you're taking a function and it's mapping to values. So rather you're mapping values to values. You have a domain and a range. So you're mapping values to values. So those are first order functions. Higher order functions are mapping functions to functions. So d by dx is, we're taking a function, the output is a function. Integrals, input is a function, output is a function. So those are higher order functions. All other functions which map values to values are first order functions. So we'll see passing closures to functions, returning closures from functions. So let's extend the same example. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to define a function called adder. So adder will basically return a lambda which adds, sorry, a closure which adds two integers here. So I would say return a b in a plus b. Okay, sorry. So this should be returning. These arrows are a problem sometimes, like Haskell, too many arrows. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, that's compiled. Now what I can do is I can call the binary operator. So adder is a higher order function because it is returning a function, a, b, a plus b, it's an anonymous function, it's being returned. Now I can say, 100 and 200 and I can just call adder there. So just print it. Yeah, 300. Now you can actually reduce it by only one step. You can say $0 plus $1. Gives you the same output. But if you say just return plus, that doesn't work. Compile time error. Yeah, that would have been cool. So let's, just for the sake of, just add a concat function for strings. It returns a string, a function which takes two strings and returns a string. So return same thing again. You can actually write a generic there. Say binary operator functional conf 2016 and the concat timed out. Yeah, function conf 2016. So we saw what are, how higher order functions are written. It's very simple. Binary operator is a higher order function because it is taking a function, and adder and concatter are higher order functions because they are returning a function. Here, yeah, this is needed. Yeah. It doesn't. So you have to. I think you have to at least mention the type once. Other than the primitives, that is integers, doubles and all that, you have to mention the types. You could use any. That's just like, yeah, you could, yeah. Actually, I was saying that you could use a generic. So what you could do is, you could say T. just see error here. Should work. No. Binary operator plus cannot be applied on two T operands. Maybe. Yeah. So let's move on. Next, I want to take you through map, filter, and reduce. These are three common operations on sequences. Apply the same transformation on all the elements of a sequence. Select a few elements from the sequence and reduce all elements of the sequence to a single element. So, how many of you have tried functional programming here? Okay, so most of you must have tried map, filter, reduce, right? That's something very basic. So, so I need not take you through the semantics of map, filter, and reduce. I'll just write a program which uses all these three. So, again, a prime number sum, sum of squares of all primes between 2 and n. So, let's start. Let's start with a function is prime, which takes an integer, returns a boolean. Now, if you want to test for divisibility, you can actually test from 2 to the square root of x, but that will make things complicated. So I'll test from 2 to x minus 1. Okay, you get it right. For prime number, if you want to test divisibility, it's enough to test it up to the square root, you know, the floor or the ceiling of the square root. But let's do it up to x minus 1. So return x is greater than 1 and now I want to try dividing x by all numbers between 2 and x minus 1. So I'll use a range here. 2 to x. This is a half closed range, it is called. Because when I say 2 dot dot lesser than x, it means from 2 to x minus 1. If I added another dot here, it would mean 2 and x including both inclusive of. So this, now I will filter all those divisors which were all those integers which were able to divide x. Is that filter clear? So what I'm doing is, first of all, x should be greater than 1 because 0 and 1 are not primes, and then I am taking all the integers between 2 and x, excluding x, and filtering out only those which are dividing x. And then I can say the count of that should be 0, which means there are no divisors. Is that simple or is it complex? Are you following what I did here? So this part is clear. Now here what I'm doing is I'm taking x and I want to divide x by all numbers between 2 and x minus 1. And I want to make sure that there is no such number which divides x. So I'm filtering it using x percentage dollar, which means each of these numbers will try to divide x, and if it is 0, it will go into an array. So if the count of the array is non-zero, which means there are divisors between 2 and x. If the count of the array is 0, it means there are no divisors. Yeah, we don't need to put this.
Because it's the only argument.
Yeah, so it's the only argument. It's a trailing closure. Got it? Okay, fine. So let's print is prime 1, that should be false, just testing. is prime 2 should be true, true, is prime 9 should be false, false, is prime 13 should be true, true. So we have a function is prime. Now the problem was find the sum of squares of all primes between 2 and n. So let's write a function, sum of squares and let's take n as an argument and we return integer here. Now I'll do the same thing. From this time I'll run from 2 to n. It's a range from 2 to n and I'm going to filter out only the primes. So I'm going to say filter is prime. It looks like Java 8. And then I'm going to map it to the square. Okay, and then I have to find the sum of it. So I'll just say reduce, start with 0, add. I'll just say return. Does that compile? It compiles. So sum of squares, let's take 5. So if you take 5, it'll be 2 square plus 3 square plus 5 square. That is 38. Let's print it out. 38. If you want any other numbers, say 10, some different answer there. So we have written a code that writes the sum, that calculates the sum of squares of all primes starting from 0 to a particular number. Now this is very concise. I don't think there is any boilerplate. If you think it can be reduced further, I'll be happy to do it. So this is performance. Swift is a native language, so I don't think anybody has made performance tests of functional code versus non-functional code. I have not come across any. But there have been performance benchmarks using something called reference types and value types. So if you start using Swift, you have the concept of a class and the concept of a structure. A class is a reference type and a struct is a value type. When you say value type, you don't have, so when you say a struct x and you say y equal to x and then eventually you change y, x and y will point to two different memory locations. So those are value types. So value, Apple is pushing Swift programmers to start using value types because it's safer to use value types when you're doing concurrent programming. Now there are performance benchmarks which prove that the performance of value types is not as good as the performance of reference types. So that's the only performance comparison I've come across. If you use a class, yeah, it's a reference type. If you use structs, structs are just like classes, only instead of a class you write a struct in your program. But the compiler deals with it differently. Yes, it's just like a class, you know, from a language perspective, but it is dealt differently by the compiler. That was the next topic. So by default, sequences in Swift are not lazy. So if you want to make them lazy, you have to use dot lazy. That let's see an example for that. It's not going to cause any improvements here, I guess. So the next one is, as you guessed, it's about lazy sequences. So map and filter are by default eager operations in Swift. Unlike Java 8 streams, which are, everything is lazy. In Java 8 streams, there are non-terminal operations and terminal operations. So map, filter, all these are non-terminal operations. only sum, average, min, max, reduce, basically all reductions are terminal operations. So in lazy sequences, computations are deferred until results are in demand. Closures can be stored and executed on demand, so you avoid needless storage and computation. So let's see an example of an infinite sequence and lazy arrays. So let's define an arithmetic series which is infinite. So you can say in arithmetic series you have an A, that is the first element, and then there is a common difference. So there is D. And okay, I need to go back to my code. How do you call them? Not sure about the type here. Let's use sequence and try. So return sequence. This is how you use it. You say first and the next. So you say the first element is something, and to calculate the next element, you give a closure. Let's see if this compiles. It's not compiling. Not sure what the type of this should be, so let's shut this off. I'll just say let arithmetic series equal to this one. Oops. Yeah, so let's start with 10 and common difference of 3. Now if you print this. Now this is an arithmetic, we don't know where to stop. It is starting with 10 and every next element is calculated using 0, that is current element plus 3. Now if I print this arithmetic series, it says unfold sequence because it has just created a recipe. It has not actually run the calculations. It does the calculations only when you say call a prefix of 10. Prefix of 10 means give me the first 10 elements of that infinite series. Still it is not. Still it is lazy. What do we do for that? Okay. So prefix is also not giving you the actual sequence. I think the actual it's asking you to give some operation. So that's what I had done. So you can actually say this. Sorry. So what I've done here is this is an infinite series, and then I said arithmetic series dot prefix 10. Still it gave me back a lazy sequence. And only when I said you reduce it by adding a plus, that is when it actually calculated the elements of it. Only the first 10 elements, I guess. And then it added them and gave me back the result. Now let's see if we have a map and a filter, how many times they are called if you have a normal sequence and how many times if you have a lazy sequence. So let's have a function called cube plus 2x. It takes an integer, returns an integer. Short of time, and I'll return x plus 2 into x. Now let me also have another called is odd, which says return x percentage 2 equal to 1. So there are I'm writing two functions. One is calculating the Sorry, this should be bool. One is calculating the cube plus 2 times of x, and the other is returning if it is a odd number. Now let's define, let's put prints here. Print. Hi. Print hello. So say 1 to 10 dot map. +2x dot filter. Actually, it should be first because this filter won't work otherwise. Filter is r dot map +2x. Now, if I just print this, see what happened. It ran the filter in the map, the filter 10 times, okay, then only 5 were filtered out because the others were even, only 5 odds were filtered out, and then it ran the map only 5 times and it gave you this. Now instead of this, if I use lazy here, nothing's going to happen for now. It'll just give me it'll return a recipe of what needs to be done. Here that recipe is very ugly, though it's actually the name of a class, I think. No, we are actually printing the object returned by this expression. Which example? I think that will happen if you say for each print. I'm not sure, but let us try. Printing every element is different from printing the. Yeah, but for each for printing is violating functional programming because you know why? Let's try. For each is taking a closure. Warning came up. I'm not sure, I've never tried this. Anyway, for each you can't have prints in for each because print is a side effect. And closure should be free from side effects. So now I'll just print the first element of this. I'll say dot first. Yeah. When I said dot first, it ran hello once, it found that it is an odd, so it ran hi, and then it printed 3. So this is the beauty of lazy sequences. Only when you need a computation, you are running it. Unlike the default in Swift, which is eager. So do you get this point? Thanks. Let's move across. You know who this guy is? That is optional. I'll take you through options. Very important. So, how many Haskellers here? Haskellers will not like Swift, I'm sure. So, this guy is Haskell Curry. He was a mathematician, and the language Haskell is named after him. And his second name is also used, Currying. And there is also a language called Curry. But currying as a concept was introduced by someone called Sean Finkel, but Haskell Curry was working in parallel to Sean Finkel, apparently I've read so. And currying is a better name. It will be very difficult saying Sean Finkeling and un-Sean Finkeling. So currying and uncurrying is better. So currying is applying one argument at a time to multi-argument functions. So lambda calculus inherently is, if I'm not wrong, single variable. So then the question was, how will you apply multiple variables? How will you accommodate functions which take multiple variables? And the answer was currying, which meant you apply one variable at a time. So if you have an addition function, you apply one variable first, it returns a function with a single variable, and then you apply that next variable. So they become very relevant in the context of higher order functions. I think in if you talk about real life, then I think they improve readability, but there was one more person who was talking about F-sharp and he said that they help you abstract behavior between layers. So that's a good point, but because I've never used currying in my day-to-day job, but I can give you an example here. So let's say you have composition. Let's say we have some nouns here, cat, dog, pen, paper, chair. Now I'm interested in two operations. One is append, prefixing a, so making a cat, a dog, a pen, a paper, a chair, and then prefixing the cat, the dog, the pen, the paper, the chair. So I can write a lambda for that, a closure, sorry. So you can say nouns. So if I wanted to append a, so I can say nouns dot map a plus zero. Because we don't have time, we'll violate the principles of functional programming. So it's printing a dog, a cat, so on. Now I also want to append the. So it becomes the. Now, if you show this code to someone, he will not understand what is this. Okay, fine, it is appending a space, but what is a space? What if he doesn't know this array? So what if you want to sound more declarative? Okay, so what you could do is you could declare a function that appends a to a string and returns a string. So you will say return a plus x, and the same thing you would do for the, and then you would say append a, and here you would say append the. Should also work, yeah. But the problem here is there is repetition here. Sorry, there is repetition here. If these functions were big, then there would be a lot of repetition. You're doing the same thing twice. So the question is, can you do it once? So anybody would say, just say append here, and just say prefix. And just call it, make it a string, and then just say prefix.x. I'll just remove this, and I'll just say append a $0. But this is as bad as the first. It's not working. Not return a closure, I think. Append. Oh, sorry. So this should be like this. I think this was the problem. So this is as bad as the first one. So why don't we keep this function and curry it? So I would say append a is, prefix A is a indefinite article. So indefinite article. But here, I'll have to change this. So instead of having this syntax, I'll say append is a function which takes a string and returns a function which will take a string and return a string. This is where it gets a little painful. Too many arrows. Okay. Now, prefix indefinite article can be append a, and then prefix definite article can be append the, and then here you use map prefix indefinite article, and here you use map prefix definite article. See if this compiles. Unresolved identifier at 22. This should return a closure. So the closure would be x in prefix plus x. Yeah. So this is what currying is. So you are applying only one argument the first time, and then that half-baked object is a function which will take another argument, and that you are passing to the map. So as I said, currying becomes relevant in the context of higher order functions like map. Yeah, exactly. You can say prefix plus $0. Yeah, fine. So that's about currying. I'm really short of time. So let's move to pattern matching. I had a lot of code to write here. I have only half an hour left. So pattern matching. So I'll show you from because none of you have you tried Haskell? The simple algebraic data types, you know, array to list and list to array. So something like that we can do in Swift. So first, I'll just copy paste code now because I'm running short on time. So let's see. So this is a function. This is to show you the power of the switch case. Now I want to traverse a square which is one which is in the first quadrant. So one corner is located at 0, 0. Okay, I want to traverse it in the anti-clockwise direction. So I want to go on the, so for you, I want to go on the x-axis first, then up, then here, and then down. Now imagine doing that using a for loop. You imagine the number of conditions you will put there. But with pattern matching in Swift, it's really easy. So what I'm doing here is I'm writing a function called visit. S is the side of the square. X and Y are the points at any given moment. So as soon as I enter this, I say I have visited XY. And then to move to the next point, case 0, 0 is returned because I'm starting at 1, 0 and I want to come back to 0, 0. So case 0, 0 is stop. This is for the horizontal line, which is on the x-axis. It's a range. So you're switching on x and y. If x lies between 1 and s and y is 0, just move ahead. So you say visit x plus 1, 0. Or you can say x plus 1, y. Then the next case is for the vertical line, which is from s0 to ss. And this is the pattern for that, and if your matches this pattern, you're just moving one point upwards. The third case is for that horizontal line on the top. Okay, your x is between 1 and s and your y is constant there at s, so you're just decrementing x in that case, x minus 1 y. And the fourth one is you're coming down. So this is a very nice example of using pattern matching in using a switch case. If you go through the Apple docs, there are actually 6 to 7 ways of doing pattern matching. This is just one of them. So for square of say side 5, if I run this code, it prints how it visited. So you can see here 1020, then it went to 5, then it started going up, then came back, and it stopped at 00. So this is how cool it is to use pattern matching using the switch case. One question you can ask here is, so do you see a problem here in this code? What if the square was really huge? What if it had, what if it, if the side was a million? No, this is not lazy, but what if this was huge? There's recursion here. You would hit a Stack Overflow, but there is tail recursion in Swift. You need not do anything special for it. So there are blog posts which actually study the compiled code and prove that tail recursion is there in Swift. So now I wanted to show this particular example of pattern matching, something like what we do in Haskell. So let's say, here we'll talk about enums. So let's define an enum. So enums are like something like algebraic data types. I don't know the text, but enums are enumerators, of course, but they are not as simple as the enumerators which come with the traditional languages like Java, C++. So you can say enum list, they are actually a collection of types. So enum list, I can say it can be, a list can be, this cons is from Lisp and Haskell, a cons which has an integer and another list, or it has nil. So which means a list is either a node which has an integer and another list, or it is nil. So it's defining the list recursively. So if I compile this, it says you're using this list recursively, so you have to add indirect here. So when I say this, it takes that definition. Now I'll just copy paste code. Now what I want to do is I want to convert an array to a list. So I write a function to list, which will take an array and return a list of this type. Now, if you have tried this simple example in Haskell, you will be able to relate to it. What this is doing is whenever you call list, it is switching on the array. If your array is empty, it is returning nil, because list cons can represent list, nil also represents list. So when your array is empty, it's returning nil. If your array is not empty, then it is extracting the first element, it is putting it here, and then it is calling toList on the rest, and that is the second associated value for this cons. Yeah, the dot is because it should actually be list.nil, and this should be list.cons, because they are defined as a part of the enum. But Swift says you're spared of that pain, as if it is a big thing. And if you add just a description here, yeah. So just look at the enum. So you have, the enum has two types. It's a collection of two types. One is a cons, and the associated values are an integer and another list. Just imagine a list. Every node of the list has some data, and it has a pointer to the list, the rest of the list. Every node does that, except for the last node, which has no pointer. Okay. Now here you are saying, list is either an element which has an integer and a list, or it is nil. Because if you, even if you consider the last element, it has an integer and it has a nil list. So whenever you're constructing it from an array, so you switch on the array. If the array is empty, there is nothing to do, so you just return nil. Switching on the array is, so it'll try to match this case. No, this is matching directly on the array. See, you are saying array let x where x dot is empty. So you are, in short, you are doing x equal to array and x dot is empty. Referential transparency. And then you return dot nil. And then otherwise, you just extract the first element, you put it in the cons, and then you call toList on the rest. It's a recursive thing. Now with this description, if you simply call this, say println, this is our, oh my god, you should say list l dot description something, so this is how it looks. This is a very basic function in exercise in Haskell actually. Yeah, it's a pair of values. It's a pair of an integer and another list. So see this, cons is one here and the rest of the list. The rest of the list, this cons is two here and the rest of the list. So the cons is a tuple. Cons is a tuple of an integer and a list, another list.
We not write any tuple keyword.
No. So this is actually, I wanted to show that this works just like Haskell. Haskell has, I think all fundamental exercises in Haskell have this example. So I wanted to show that algebraic data types are something which are simulated by enums. Okay, so we have 15 more minutes. Do you want to, so I have two options. Either we do only memoization, or we do functors, applicatives and monads, functors. Okay. So just a short description on memoization. So yesterday there was a big debate on referential transparency, right? There is a concept of pure functions. A pure function is a function which for any given value it will always give you the same output. Okay, so Fibonacci is the best example for a pure function, because there are no external dependencies, there are no side effects which are being factored into it. Any value, it will always give you the same, it will be always mapped to the same value. In that case, why can't you cache the values? That is the rationale behind memoization. I think in closure, memoization is very it's built into the language. But in Swift, it's not built into the language. You have to write your own function to memoize, and it does give you speed up. So if you are interested, just visit my GitHub profile. There is a folder called functional conf, and in module 4 there is a memoize function. This is the memoize function. You're basically caching values, and instead of calculating them again and again, you are using them. Okay, so I will move to functors now. Now I have also had a very basic understanding of functors, applicatives and monads. So in a nutshell, you can say that they are containers which hold objects, and they follow certain protocols. You know, they hold the objects, and they expose a certain interface which you can use for your own benefits. So a functor is very simple. If you have a function from A to B, then for a given functor, if you apply that function, and if the functor is containing A, then the resultant will be a functor with B. Now let me make it very simple here. I will use arrays because we have not yet seen what are optionals. So say we have hello functional conf. Now this is an array of strings. What if you wanted to convert it to an array of string lengths? You need not do much. You just have to say map dot characters dot count So just look at it this way. You have an array which is a container and it has some strings, and now you are doing an operation on array without fetching those strings one by one, and the results of that operation are again in an array. Are you following it? You have an array and you are applying a particular operation. Now actually this operation is what? It's a function on which takes a string and returns an integer dot characters dot count. Now you are applying that on an array. You are applying that on a container of strings, and what you're getting is a container of ints. So it is of the it, you can say that for f from string to int, you are able to apply it on a array of strings and get an array of ints. So it is the quality of that array which is allowing you to apply a function to all its members and throw out result which is again in an array. That simple thing is called a functor. Anything, any container, or as it was being explained there in the previous session, any box. So you have a box, you have some data in it, and you apply a function which is actually defined on that data, not on the box, and it gives you another box with the output. So here we had strings in a box, we applied a function which was actually on strings and returned, and it was supposed to return integers, and we had a box. Now we have a box of integers. So we have two things. We have a function from string to int and we have a box of strings, and what we are getting is a box of integers. We never had a function which ran on a box of strings. We had a function which ran on only on strings. So it's as simple as that. Anything which can implement map is a functor in terms of Swift. Outside also, the very simplistic definitions, there is a huge amount of math involved behind it. I'm not sure how much of it is there, but in simple terms, anything on which you can apply a map is a filter. So optionals, so we were talking about optionals, right? So in Swift we have this concept of optionals, where you can say, I can say x int equal to 10, and then if I say print x, it's going to just print 10. But if I put a question mark here, which means x is an optional int, which means it can either have a value or it can be nil. So if I print x now, it says optional of 10. It doesn't say 10. Now if I just say nil here, I can say nil here. So it says nil. Now the point I'm making here is optional is also a functor. Why? Because let's have a string equal to hello. Now again the same thing. Characters.count is a function from strings to integers. Now let me apply that here. X.map. So map is not only on arrays, it can be on optionals also. X.map. Dot characters.count. What do you think the answer will be? X is not an array, but still you can apply map. Because map is not only on sequences. It will be optional of 5. Because optional is a functor. Anything inside the optional, if you apply a function which is, so a string is, make, I'll keep it simple. See, let's go to the slide here again.
Optional is the box around the string.
Yeah, yeah.
Non-optional string.
Yes. So you have a function which is from A to B, okay? And then you have A wrapped in a box and you're applying this function on A and you are getting B in the same box. Then that box is a functor. Both the boxes have to be the same thing. Yeah. So the box is a functor. And one more profound thing about this is, if you have nil here, there is no problem. Nothing will happen. Even this will be nil. So that is what the next picture meant. If you apply that function on an empty box, you are going to get an empty box. So just imagine the amount of checks this is reducing. Otherwise, if you had to do this without a functor, everywhere you'll have to unwrap the optional. So optional unwrapping is, so when I say let x int optional equal to 10, it says optional of 10, right? If I want to get 10, I use this bang here. What are you asking? So then it says 10. So everywhere, if we didn't have the functor, we would have to check for nil. Only if it is not nil, then, you know, unwrap it. So that forced unwrapping is not a good thing. Every time, it's a guideline that every time you're unwrapping, you're doing this, you better check that there is no nil. Otherwise, you're going to crash. Yeah. So actually, null checks were missing in Swift, and later they realized it, and then they moved it to the library, saying library should take care of this. Optional is a point. Yeah. Then it's going to crash. See, error running your code. Stack trace is also. No, this is not a compile time error. It actually went to the server, it crashed and came back. Doesn't give them. Yeah, pardon me, I didn't get. Yeah, so here if you if you remove the bank, it will just print nil. Okay, but we are expecting an integer, right? So we have to use the bank. So what typically Swift programmers do, they'll say if let x1 equal to x, this is unwrapping, and then print x1. You can use guards also. So it's not printing anything here. If I say 10, it'll unwrap and it'll print this. So all these are not necessary when you're using functors. That is the point. Now talking about applicatives, so in functors we saw that the function was from A to B, and we applied it on a box containing A. Now applicatives go one step further, where the function is also in a box. This one. You have a function from A to B, and the function is also enclosed in a box, and you are applying that box function on a boxed data, and you are getting another box data. If either of them is nil, if the function is nil, nothing happens. If the data is, it's a box, if this box is empty, nothing happens. So one example for this is, so like we have map for functors, Swift doesn't have anything for applicatives, though you can extend the optional type to work as an applicative. So that's what I've done here. Let's not get into the details of this code because we don't have time. So what I'm doing here is I'm defining a function called apply. So I'm extending optional here. So you can extend any data type in Swift. So I'm extending optional here, and only in short, don't go into the code. In short, only if the incoming function is valid, I am calling map. Otherwise, I am returning none, which means I'm just trying to do this. You have a function and you have a boxed function, and you are applying the boxed function on boxed data. Now, if either the boxed function or the boxed data don't exist, then the result will not exist. Only if both the function box has a function, the data box has data, only then you will unwrap them, you will apply them, put it in the same box and send it. So that is, see, this understanding is not my understanding. There is a very good blog post by a person called Aditya Bhargava. You can actually visit, I think it's adit.io, and he has demystified functors, applicatives and monads in an awesome way. And Swift programmers can actually, there is another post for Swift programmers, which is by Daniel Steinberg. He has actually translated Aditya Bhargava's post to Swift. He can actually give the Swift code there to demystify functors, applicatives and monads. So that was about applicatives. Monads are one step further. I don't think we have time to discuss that. Only if you're interested, we can catch up later and just go through it. Yes, it is typically, yeah, so they say that in memoization, the function has to remember the mapping, which means it is, it's local to the function. It actually, it's having state, but that is not changing. It's not changing. So, yeah, that's a good point, but as long as it doesn't change, it's, that's why it's possible only for pure functions. Yeah, very rarely. So I have, I basically work on the foundation libraries at the library level, and there have been a couple of instances where we wanted to retain some data and it got cleaned up because of automatic reference counting. So it's very rare. Very rare use cases. Okay, so okay, I have time for that. So, have you heard of Bluemix? Yeah. So, Bluemix is IBM's PaaS platform. So, just like Amazon has AWS and Microsoft has Azure, IBM has Bluemix. And we want, so we see that there is a huge Swift developer ecosystem out there. So there are 11 million developers, Swift developers in the world. And because it's growing, Swift as a language has shot up from position number 28 to position number 13 in 2 years on the TIOBE index. So we think that one limitation of Swift is, today, if you are a startup and you are interested in, you have a cool idea, you come up with an app, but for writing the server-side components, you have to resort to another language. You can't do that in Swift. So people, currently I think Node, Java and Python. These are very popular. So companies, typically they write the client apps in Swift and the server apps in one of these languages. So the question is, if Swift is made available on Linux, why can't you write the server components as well in the same language? So we have released Swift on Bluemix in the form of a web services framework called Kitura. So now you can actually host your web services in Swift inside Kitura. Kitura is just like Express.js, Node Express, it's inspired by Express. So that is the motivation, because there is a huge ecosystem out there which is not able to do server-side programming in Swift. not sure of anything yet. Because Kitura got GA'd just last month. So there is something called capture lists. When you're writing a closure, you can actually mention a list of what to capture. And I think the object will be captured because self, if you're using self inside your closure, the object gets captured there and it is retained.
But self is not used.
If you're not using it, yeah, that is where we had a problem. I had a problem. And that is where, so there is a concept of cycles in, so if you have an object A and object B, and A is pointing to B and B is pointing to A, there is a cycle. Both will not get collected. So in such cases, I think we forge a cycle and we break it when we want to break it. Because as you said, the self, if self is not captured, you're going to crash somewhere later. So we have had instances where a local variable was not captured in the closure, and some we went ahead and crashed somewhere. And ideally, programmers expect it to be captured because that's how it works on Mac. So we had to hold on to it using a cycle, and then break the cycle whenever we wanted to break. So that is like manual memory management. So that is why I'm saying it's painful at times. It's not like it's not as easy as the Java garbage collector. I don't think it may be detecting, but it's not a problem because you can intentionally maintain cycles. That's what I have done once. Stack allocate, yes. Yeah, I think there is a mailing list called Swift Evolution, and that is out of all the mailing lists that Swift Evolution has the maximum traffic. If you subscribe to it, you get around 1,000 to 1,500 emails per day, because the language is under it's in a flux. It's in still in a, under transformation, because I think they are not happy with the generics. I myself for this particular thing, for that list cons problem, I was planning to use generics, but I got spiraled into the generics problem, and generics are really difficult to comprehend. So I think generics is something they plan to fix further in Swift 4. Swift 3 was a very aggressive release, a lot of ABI changes. So that won't be there in Swift 4, I think. Swift 4 will have major improvements. But if you're interested in the evolution of the language, do subscribe to Swift Evolution. There's a mailing list. So even the currying function that I showed you, the syntax of currying in Swift was much easier, but somehow somebody convinced that this is better, and they got this syntax. Otherwise you could just say x int, brackets, y int, z int. That would be a curried function. But now it's all about arrows, because they wanted to be the arrows. Cocoa pods? you're talking about. So I'm not sure about CocoaPods, but there is the new format called Swift Package Manager. So CocoaPods is a package manager. Apple has come up with another format for package management, and that's called Swift Package Manager, SPM. So there is a, IBM hosts a catalog called Swift Package Catalog. I'm not sure how much of what you need is there, but you can just see IBM Swift Package Catalog. You have around 1,500 to 2,000 packages which are present on GitHub. But I'm not sure if what you need will be available here. You can just search it here. Yeah, so right now I wouldn't say that it is going to be functional on its own unless somebody has worked on it. Because still, frankly, there are differences between Linux and Mac, that is Darwin, a lot of differences. So any other questions, we can just catch up. So that's the problem. Objective-C libraries can be used in Swift only on Apple platforms because they exist on Apple platforms. But when you come to Linux, they don't exist there. So that's what I'm involved in. So there are these foundation libraries, all the next step classes, NSString, NSDate, NSCalendar. These were available. These were actually inherited from Objective-C. And currently on Apple, you are just the library is actually built from Objective-C, and you just have a Swift overlay. By overlay, I mean just a wrapper, and then you are reaching out to it. But that doesn't exist on Linux. So you have to have a clean room implementation of the foundation classes on Linux. So that is what the Swift CoreLibs Foundation project does.